Hi everyone. So today we'll continue our object-oriented thinking chapter. And if you remember last time, we stopped at strings. So I will continue with strings. So if you remember, the place where we stopped were these functions. These are functions that basically return a new string for every one of these functions, except split, which returns an array of strings, but they basically are instance functions for the string class. For a string, you can basically return a new string with all letters in lowercase, all letters in uppercase. You can trim the beginning white spaces at the beginning and at the end of a string and return a new string with those blank spaces trimmed. The replace method takes one character and replaces every occurrence of that character with another character. Replace first takes a string and replaces it, replaces the first occurrence of the old string with a new string. Replace all takes a string and replaces every occurrence, every distinct occurrence of that old string with a new string. And the split, if you remember, we did it last time, basically takes a delimiter and does tokenization. It splits the original string on that delimiter and returns the rest of the strings left. Now, here are some examples. For instance, welcome to lowercase returns welcome all letters in lowercase. Welcome to uppercase returns a new string that has all letters in uppercase. If we have spaces before and after at the end, the string.trim will basically return welcome without the white spaces at the beginning and at the end. And then we have the replace methods. Replace a character E with A. For welcome returns WALCOM uppercase A. So basically it replaces both E's, lowercase E's with uppercase A. The same thing happens if replace first the string that contains the letter E is replaced with the string that contains A and B, uppercase. So replace first will only replace the first occurrence of an E. Replace all replaces all occurrences of E's. So the first one and the last one. Replace all EL, because there is only one EL in welcome, it will be replaced with AB. So we have WAB. COME as the response, as the return string. Now, split, I proved it to you last time using a sentence with spaces, but you can split on any character that you want. In fact, all of these functions work not only with strings, but with regular expressions. So basically, replace all, replace first and split can use regular expressions. And I can show you an example and then describe to you what regular expressions mean. Regular expressions are a way to actually specify not only a single string, but any number of strings by a singular expression. For instance, let's say that we want the split, the replace all method to work on dollar sign plus or the hash sign. So in this case, we want any one of those to be replaced by the string NNN. Now, there are many ways to do this. You can basically replace the plus, then on the result of that replacement, replace the dollar sign. On the result of that replacement, replace the hash sign. But in Java and many other programming languages, there are what are called regular expressions. For instance, the regular expression here says that any one of the characters inside, so the square brackets define that there is a regular expression that takes any disjunction of inner patterns. And inside we have dollar sign plus and hash sign. So either one of them will be replaced with triple N. So for instance, if we print out the result of this, it will print this result where every one of the characters plus dollar sign and hash sign was replaced with a triple N. So now this regular expression, open bracket, dollar sign plus hash sign close bracket is a regular expression pattern that matches any one of those characters. And I can show you actually this in Java. So here is the example that we had there. We replace any one of these characters with triple N, and the result basically contains three N's for the plus sign, three N's for the dollar sign, and three more N's for the hash sign. Now, let me explain to you what regular expressions are. Languages, and in this case, I'm talking about all languages. It could be natural language, control natural language. They could be programming languages. Are basically formed out of vocabulary or alphabet, even a better alphabet, and grammar rules. So usually you have some kind of how the characters can actually be together in a word. So either alphabet or vocabulary and grammar rules. Now, depending on the efficiency of parsing a language, languages can be characterized or classified as different types. So for instance, what is called the Chomsky hierarchy of languages says that there are languages that can be recognized by a deterministic finite automata. So, finite automata. And those are the regular languages or regular expressions. And there are more complex languages for which you need actually to use a pushdown parser or some kind of more complicated parsing algorithm. So there are context-free languages, context sensitive languages. And each one of these can actually be divided into smaller subunits. For instance, even regular expressions, there are sub languages of regular expressions. There are locally parsable languages or local languages. Like for instance, a string is in the language if it can be recognized that is in the language with a sliding window over the string of a fixed size, no matter how long is the string. And then there are also piecewise local languages. There are clean star languages. Clean star, basically the idea of clean star is that you want to repeat a pattern as many times as you want. So clean star. Here is an example. Let's say that I want to say that any number of A's followed by a B, that's one language. So in this case, basically the star, it's like zero or more occurrences of the language of that character. Are programming languages context-free? Yes. So context-sensitive languages are those languages in which when you have a rule, like for instance, let's take one from linguistics. In a sentence, you must have an agreement between the noun, the number of the noun, like for instance, if it's plural, is followed by a verb in the same number. So basically you have a sensitivity between the different parts of the sentence. For context-free languages, you don't have such a case. You basically build, let's say a loop is there is no context free there. It's a, let's say it's either a for loop or it's a while loop or it's a do while loop and so on. And then you define what a for loop means. So a for loop is basically the string for followed by open parentheses, followed by basically a statements probably, followed by a comma or semicolon actually, followed by a Boolean expression and so on. So basically you can define the language, every component is independent from others. You don't have like in linguistics, basically that when you have the person, the noun or the pronoun in singular, then the verb must be in singular, third person. Okay. The advantage of context, so actually there are advantages of each one of them. So basically efficiency of regular expressions is in the size of the string. So you can recognize that a string is in the language in the size of the string. So for instance, this is, let's say the n is the size of the string. In n steps, you can recognize that the string is in the language. And why is that? Because all of these regular expressions can be transformed into a deterministic finite automaton. So for instance, we had our case before that I wanted from an initial state. Let me represent some initial state. So from this initial state, I want to recognize that either one of the characters, let's say plus, I don't remember what were the other characters, dollar sign and hash sign are basically taking me to a final state. So how I can do this? Actually, the notation, I messed it up a little bit. This is a final state. And an initial state starts with an arrow coming into it, just basically a simple arrow coming from nowhere into it. That's an initial state. And then we can have basically, if we have plus, we can get from the from that initial state to the final state. If we have dollar, we can get to the final state. And if we have hash sign, we can get to the final state. So basically, for every, you start from the beginning and you start, I want to recognize strings. And let's say that the string is just a plus. So then it's easy, we just start from the initial state and try to recognize plus, we follow a single link and we go to a final state, so we recognize plus, okay? So deterministic finite automata, you start from an initial state and in a finite number of steps, as many characters as you have in the language, you can recognize if the character, if the string is in the language or not. Let me give you a more complex example. Let's say that I have this regular expression, basically any number of A's followed by any number of B's. So I want to recognize such a string, all the strings that have this form, some number of A's followed by some number of B's. So it happens that in this case, actually, we have the initial state, it's also a final state, because any number of A's could be nothing. And now, if we have an A, it will take us from the current state to itself. So an A transition, it's really just, it takes us from the current state to itself, okay? And then a B transition, if we get at least one B, we basically get, this is a B, we get to also a final state. In that final state, we have, so it's also, oops, also final state. But in this final state, we also have a self-transition. Any number of B's will take us to itself, back to itself. Okay. So this is a deterministic finite machine. We plug in any text. For instance, if we enter ABC, it follows A once, gets back to state zero. It follows B to state one, and then C cannot be, there is no edge going for C. And similar, like if I have A, B, A, I can get with A back to state zero, then from state zero to state one, and then I don't have an A transition. So it recognizes strings that are in the language or not in the size of the string. Okay. So that's exactly what regular expressions do. Java has a lot of regular expressions. Here is another example. We have split that takes either one of these characters, dot, comma, colon, semicolon, question mark, and it splits on all of them. So if we have this string, Java, comma, C, question mark, C sharp, comma, C++, basically it splits on all of those characters. So it uses comma to split, so we extract Java. Then it uses question mark to split and it extracts C. It uses comma again and it extracts C sharp. And then C++ is the rest of the string because plus was not in the string and neither was sharp. So you can match and split on a regular expression, on a pattern. And now what are the special type of characters in patterns? So the first one is star. So star by itself is basically any number of the previous character. Now, dot is also a regular expression. It's any character. So really, Java is fun matches java.star means does this Java is fine start with Java and has any suffix possible. Dot means any character. Star means any repetition of the previous pattern. So any possible suffix will be recognized by dot star. So Java is fun does match Java dot star because dot star is any suffix. Similarly, Java is cool dot matches Java dot star. It also is true because basically it also matches. Then we have slash d means any digit. So now, because we are actually inside the string, because slash by itself, backward slash, is actually an escape character, we need to escape it twice. So in order to have it in the regular expression as escape d, we need to double escape d. Then this expression that we see below, it recognizes social security numbers. So for instance, any three digits followed by a dash, followed by two digits, followed by a dash, followed by four digits. Okay. Let's do some experiments. So I will start with the two above and show them to you. So here we have just a print statement and we are printing, is it true that Java is fun matches java.star? And it says true because it has the prefix Java. And then this is any suffix. Dot means any character. Star means any repetition of the previous pattern. This is also matched by Java is cool. It's also true because basically is cool is matching the dot star here. Okay. Now, how do we check if a string is a social security number? So let's say that I have a social security number 111-22-3333, and I want to see if it matches the pattern for a social security number. I should have left the double quotes there. So this is a way to basically recognize the fact that this string contains 3 digits followed by a dash followed by 2 digits followed by a dash followed by 4 digits. So it recognizes any number like this. It recognizes 111, maybe 123, 44, followed by, let's say, 6, 7, 8, 9. So that's also a social security number because it's basically 3 digits followed by 2 digits followed by 4 digits separated by dashes. If one of them is wrong, like for instance, is missing a character, it will be false. That's not a social security number. Similarly, if I have 2 extra characters, like an extra character, it's also false. So really that recognizes social security numbers and nothing else. Another example, how do we check if a number in a string is even? And basically this is the regular expression. So let's say that I have this number and I want to see if it's an even number or an odd number. And I don't want to translate it to as a string and as a number and then basically try it. Try all the possible numbers in an interval to see if they are numbers. So now it says false, basically tells me that it's not an even number because it's a number of digits, but it doesn't end with one of the even digits, 0, 2, 4, 6, 8. So for instance, if this would have ended with 2, then it would have recognized the fact that that is an even number. Okay. So it's really a way to recognize this. For all of them, I can write you a DFA because in this case it's easy. You start from the initial state, you must see 3 digits, then you must see a dash, then you must see another 2 digits, another dash, and another 4 digits. And for all of that, you basically have a long DFA with a sequence of edges that take you from state to state towards the end. Similarly here you can represent this as a self loop, as a digit self loop. And then basically if it's one of these even integers, it takes you to the final state. It's basically an even number. Similarly, if you want to recognize phone numbers, because parentheses actually, they are also used for disjunction, but for disjunction between strings, not between just characters, you need to escape the parentheses itself because it's a regular expression. So any phone number starts with open parentheses, 3 digits, but the first digit cannot be 0. So it has to start with 1 to 9. 1-9 means the interval from 1 to 9. It's in brackets. So it basically it's a disjunction, says either one of the digits from 1 to 9. Then we have 2 digits, so open bracket digit 2 and then cardinality 2, and then we have again escape character and the close bracket followed by 3 digits followed by dash followed by 4 digits. And I have a big list of regular expressions. I will go over all of it. So if you have some character, have for instance Java, that character is basically matches only that character. So Java matches Java. If you have a disjunction, either AB or CD, then you put them into parentheses separated by vertical bar. Any single character, one single character is represented by period. Any character in the set from A to C. So you can basically represent them in the brackets, meaning that any one of these characters. If you put a hat, the caret sign in front of it, it means any character except those characters, A, B, C. If you have an interval, two characters where one has a lower Unicode than another, you can use dash to represent all the possible characters from the beginning to the end, including the first and the last character. If you want any character but those that are A to Z, you put a hat sign in front of it. If you want A through E or M through P, so you can put in within brackets also basically the second interval. So really what is possible is not only that you create an interval from A to E, but also the fact that you recognize M to P. Okay, and it is in a disjunction. That's why we have it here in brackets. The intersection between two intervals can be obtained with the double and sign, is like conjunction. So A to E and C to P is basically the letters between C and E. But if we don't know that that's where they overlap, we construct the conjunction like this one. Slash lowercase d means a digit. Slash uppercase d means not a digit. Slash lowercase w means a word character, like a letter, alphabetical letter. Slash upper w means a non-word character. Slash s means any white space, like space, tab, or new line. Slash uppercase s means any non-white character, like letters and digits and symbols. If you have a pattern, and you have a star after that pattern, means zero or more occurrences of that pattern P. If you have plus after it, it means one or more occurrences. And if you have question mark, it means zero or one occurrences of the pattern P. If you want a precise number of repetitions of that pattern, you put P and then open curly brace, the number of that you want repetitions, close curly brace. If you want at least n, it's exactly the same as before, but we put a comma after n. So basically means that at least n, anything bigger than n is fine. And finally, if you have two ranges, like n is less than m, then you basically can use this notation, curly brace n comma m, which basically means that at least n and at most m. So these are regular expressions. For all of them, one can write a regular deterministic finite automata and basically recognize if the string satisfies that language. Is it true that slash d is the same with 0 to 9? Yes, it's true. So actually, the question is d 0 to 9 or 1 to 9? It's 0 to 9. And it's easy to actually check. So for instance, is 0, does 0 matches d? And that basically will tell us it's true. So 0, 1, for instance, but 0 included is a number. Which slide? Ah, yes, you are completely right. This is a typo. Very good. Thank you. Zero. I think the reason why I did it that way was because on the previous slide, I was doing phone numbers. And for phone numbers, they are between the first digit must be different than zero, because zero will take you as a country code. Okay. Good. Okay. So any one of these methods, matches, replace all, replace first, and split, work with regular expressions. Here I have a bunch of examples. Like for instance, I have Java, Java, Java as the string, and I replace all V's followed by a word letter, so V followed by a letter with WI. So Java contains V followed by A, and V followed by A will be changed to WI. So we basically get Javi, Javi, Javi as the result of this replacement. If I want to replace only the first occurrence with WI, it only replaces the first occurrence. So I get Javi, Java, Java. Split also works on digits. So if I have Java 1, HTML 2, Perl, split on any digit, it will return basically an array that contains in the S3 that contains Java, HTML, and Perl as separate strings. Good. I was looking if there are questions in the chat. Next, index of. So index of takes a character and returns the index of the first occurrence of that character in the string. If the character is not found in the string, it returns minus one. Index of character ch from index as an integer. So this will start looking for that character starting from index included. Index of a string returns the index of the first occurrence of the string in the bigger string, in the string for which we called this in this method. In either case, it returns minus one if it's not found. If the character that was passed or the string that was passed is not found, returns minus one. Next method is index of, takes a string, a from parameter, and looks for that string starting from that parameter included. So if from that parameter is the string, that that location is returned. Last index of has similar methods. So I have last index of a character, it returns the last index of that character. Last index of a character given a from index, and last index of a string for, given a from index. So here I have examples. For instance, I have welcome to Java and I'm looking for the first index of W. Of course, is in welcome, so it returns the position zero. Welcome to java.index of x returns minus one because there is no x in welcome to Java. Welcome to Java index of o starting with position five. So after position five, it basically looks for o. And of course, it finds it here, which is position nine, starting with index zero. Welcome to Java index of com returns three because the index of C is three. W was zero, E was one, L was two, and C was three. And that's what it returns, the index of the first position of that string as the first character of that string. Welcome to Java index of Java starting from position five. It returns 11 because the index of Java is 11. The index of the uppercase W, J. Index of lowercase Java returns minus one. There is no lowercase Java in my program, it's just uppercase Java, and Java is case sensitive. And last index of A returns 14, because that's actually the index of the last position in the array. The array has 15 elements, so 14 is the last character of that array. Now, you can convert from characters to numbers and to strings and vice versa. So the string class provides methods, value of, that converts a character or an array of characters or number values to strings. Now, you can do it in multiple ways. You can convert it with this value of methods, or another way that I will show you now is that you can actually concatenate 5.44 as a double with an empty string, and that will take you to basically the same 55.44 double, okay, but as a string. So really basically converting characters and numbers to strings can be done with the value of method or through concatenation of weak types. Any questions? Okay. Now, Java also takes command line parameters. I don't know if you noticed that when we write the main method, it takes arguments as a parameter. So what are those arguments? They are the arguments that you pass if you would run that program from the command line. So let me show you an example again. So let's say that we do get arguments, and I'm gonna write a for loop for any string, let's say s in args. I can basically just print the string, print ln s. Okay. Now I can run it in two ways in Eclipse. I can find the program, in my case is in the default package, and run this program myself with run configuration. Run as Java application is already chosen. And now I can pass the arguments. There are two arguments. There are the arguments that you have as program arguments, and there are the arguments that you pass as a parameters, like 1, 2, 3, 4. And could not load class. Okay. Let me see what's happening. Properties, Java build path. Try to save this. No, still the same problem. So let's see what's happening. This is the test class. There was no problem up to now. So it has to be something to do with this. So what if I'm defining an integer I equal to 0, I is less than args.length, I plus plus, and instead of s, I'm using args of I. Run it, still the same problem. Okay, properties, let's unselect this. Libraries, no. Let me see. The JRE is correct. Let's move it. Let's apply. Let's create a new project. I'm not quite sure what's happening. So I'm creating a new project for an existing JRE. So let's search. No, it's all good. Apply and close. So let's call this package to test. And in package 2, we will just use the class test. We run it. Same problem. Can you overload the value of for a building class? I believe so, because why not? Of course, why not? Basically, but it has to be a subclass of the string class. So I'm not sure if the string class is not final, but still I'm not quite understand why this doesn't work. Right now, I can't run any Java program. So there is something else going on. Properties. I have the correct Java path. Ah. It's not trying to run as a Java application. No. That's exactly how I'm trying to run it. I also am not using the scanner, so get rid of that. Yeah, my directory seem to be a little bit messed up. I'm sorry for that. I can't give you demos like I usually do. Basically, usually I'm showing you how you can run this from command line. Let me try to run it from command line. Why not? So let's say that I create a new text document. Let's call it test main. Java. Now we can basically try it this way. So system. Then args.length. And now we can compile it from command line. Java. Test main could not load or find. So I have a problem with probably the JDK installed on my machine, and I can't think why. Probably it's because I didn't Java Windows update. So Java C. Sorry for that. Yeah, now it's good. Java test main. Good, still good. So now if I want to actually pass more parameters, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now I have 4 parameters that are passed as parameters. So now we can modify the program. And instead of just printing the length, I'm going to iterate over. So for every string value in args, I'm going to print the value. In this case, just me. Okay, we need to recompile the program, and then we can basically run Java with the 4 parameters, and it tells me that I have 4 parameters, and those parameters are 1, 2, 3, 4. I'm not sure why this doesn't work in Eclipse. What happened with my Eclipse? I'm totally at a miss. Probably I need to install a new version of Eclipse. Anyway, any questions? So those are the command line parameters. Gregory says the class path, I think it might be, I do not know. Is that how Java does variable length arguments? Yes, that's exactly how. It's not actually, that's not true. Now that you mentioned it, this is taking an array of arguments. It's not variable length, the methods with variable number of parameters. So for that, I believe is string dot dot and then the arguments. And then you can get any number of arguments you want, but really they are an array of as many arguments as you want of that specific type. But you don't need to pass them as an array. You basically can pass them with different parameters separated by commas. So that's a different issue. Okay, good. So how do you process the command line parameters? Basically, you get this args, which is an array of strings. And you can extract them with args of 0, args of 1, args of n, which correspond to the arguments, args of 0 to args of n. For instance, let's say that I want to implement a calculator, and this calculator works in the command line. It takes the operand plus and the operator. So basically, I can modify, I can create this calculator, I can create a new class, public class calculator. And this class calculator has a public static void main method, takes an array of strings, args. And now the first parameter is the first operand of. So first of all, I have to check if the number of parameters is 3. So if args.length is different than 3, then I can tell the user system.out.println the correct way to use this class. Is calculator of operand one, operator, and operand two. Okay. And now I have to get basically if this was true, then I exit. So system exit of one. We finish the program. The user has to use this program in the correct way. Now, if that was not the case, now I need the two operands. So let's say that they were double. So double O1 is basically double dot parse double of args of 0. Then I can do the same for the second operand. Is args of 2. And now I can do a switch statement. Switch on args of 1. And now I have multiple cases. So case if the operator is plus, then basically system.out.println. Operand one plus operand two. And of course, break. And I have to do the same for multiplication, division, and so on. So let's say that this is minus, and this is multiplication. So now I finished with the switch statement. And I should probably finish with the class. Okay. The middle argument. So I basically argument 0 and argument 2 are the operands. And then argument 1 is the operator. I think I did it correctly. Yes, I think that's what Rachel responds. So let's save it on the desktop as calculator.java. And now we can try to compile it. So Java C calculator. And I had no error. And now Java calculator of 1 plus 2. And it returns 3.0. Yep, it actually worked. And here is the basically my example. You can implement in any way you want. Basically, you can parse as them as integers if you think that they will always be integers and do a switch statement on the operator. Any questions? So those are the command line arguments. Now, I can't show you in Eclipse, but in Eclipse, basically when I still have it open somewhere. So if you want to run it in Eclipse, the correct way to run it is to basically run it as a Java application, okay, which doesn't work right now. I do not know why, but then run configuration, and in run configuration, you can do two arguments. Ah, the VM arguments were weird. 1 plus 2. I will just as an example run. It works. Okay. So basically what I had for some reason, I think first time when I was trying to run it, I pasted it in the arguments, in the VM arguments for some reason, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that was the problem. So now everything works here too. I should probably change back my build path to include the library for Java. That's correct. Finish it, apply and close. And now we will be able to run even our calculator. So let's take our calculator from here and we put it in Eclipse. And now we want to run that one as a Java application. It tells us that that's not the correct way to run it. And now we can run it with the configuration arguments. And in arguments, I'm gonna pass, let's say 4 multiplied with 5. And it still tells me that is not correct. So let me see again. Do I have a space? Yeah, I do. Okay. The problem with star is that it's a special character. So maybe if I pass it as a string, then probably it will run. No, it's still, the star is a special character. So I might have to escape it. Let's try minus. Minus should work. Yeah, so I will actually try to see what how to do multiplication in command line. The problem is that star is actually used in command line for, let's say, listing all the folders. ls.star list all the folders. Basically, star replaces any file possible in the system as an input. For instance, if I want all files that end with txt, then I would use star. It's a wildcard. So that's why I can't pass this as an argument. What I think I can do is to pass it in a string. That's what I was trying to do, run as run configuration. And let's pass it as escape star. And now nothing happened. Let's try one more time. If not, I will try to figure it out. Run it. Nope, no output whatsoever. So let's put a breakpoint and try to debug it. Okay, so what are the arguments? The arguments are escape star. Huh. But okay, then why didn't it work in the first place? So let's try to run it again without escape. Run as run configuration. So what about now? Run. It tells me that it can't run it. Now let's debug it. What's in args? Okay, so that's the problem. In args now I have all the folders in the current directory. So, okay, let's kill it again. And now we'll try again. Run as run configuration. Now, what if I put the star within quotes, run, and debug? And what's in args? Still the same. Okay. So it seems to me that if I escape it, I have to escape it here too. So let me see if that is the case, but that's a weird way to run the calculator. Run as run configuration. And this time I'm gonna escape it, run. And now it worked. For some reason, it also crashed, but only once. Okay. Any questions? If you put everything within quotes, you only get one argument. So now you have to parse it yourself, basically. Okay, good. Next, the character class. We already talked about this earlier this semester. Basically, it has methods to check if a character is a digit, if it's a letter. It has methods also to compare with other characters. Basically, there is character value that given the character object returns a char value. It's basically a wrapper for a single character, but as an object. So it's the object version of one character. So we have all of the methods that we already discussed earlier this semester with isDigit, isLetter, isLetter or digit. These are all static methods. They take as a parameter a character and return Boolean or other characters if you have two lowercase or two uppercase. Other examples here, if a character object is a new character for B, then we can compare that character object with a character for A. We get one because B is greater than A with exactly one Unicode position. Comparing it with the character for B will give zero because the two characters are the same. Comparing it with the character for C, B compared with C is minus one. Comparing it with D is minus two. So basically it returns a negative number or a positive number or zero if the two characters are equal. There is also the equals method. So if we have a character object, we can check if it's equal with another character object instead of using the compare to and expecting zero. And here are two examples. Now, one thing that I told you about strings is that they are immutable. So if you have a natural language processing problem in which you basically try to tokenize a string and tokenizing basically extracts substrings or add more characters to a string. This happened to me once. I was writing an interface for XSB Prolog, the Stony Brook Prolog system, and I was using strings. And it was very slow. But that was because the way that this interface would work would be to add characters at the end of the string as the result. The problem was that really strings would create a bigger and a bigger string, a new string all the time. In Java, there are actually two more classes, alternatives for the string class, string builder and string buffer. They can be used whenever a string is used, but they also allow you to modify the string. So they have methods for adding characters or other strings, inserting at any position, appending another string to the current string. So you can modify the string, it's not anymore immutable. Okay. So here are the constructors. You can construct the string builder as an empty string, or a string builder with a default capacity. Again, this is the capacity is like the stack capacity. That is the default initial capacity to which you can add more characters because basically that allows you to add unlimited number of characters. Or you can create a string builder for a given string. Like you have the string hi, you create the string version, string builder version of hi. Now, these are all methods for string builders. What's the difference between string builder and string buffer? One of them is synchronized. That means that you can use it from two different threads and you don't have race conditions. Only one thread is in the any one of these methods that you see here at any given time. I don't remember which one is the synchronized one and which one is the non-synchronized one. I believe string buffer is the synchronized version. Okay, good. Append basically takes either another string or an array of characters and appends them at the end of the current string buffer. Append takes also a character array, an offset position in that array, and the number of length from that position, and appends the subarray to the current buffer. String buffer is synchronized. Yep. Also, append works with primitive types. Any one of the primitive types, it appends the primitive type value to the end of the string buffer or string builder. Append also takes another string and adds it at the end of the current string builder. So all of these, they basically modify the current string builder, and they also return the reference to it. So if you need that reference, you don't want to use the current variable. Delete takes the start index and the end index, and basically deletes all the characters between the start index up to the end index. If you have a single character that you want to delete, you can delete it with delete character at. Takes an index and it deletes that character. The string builder becomes shorter with one position. Insert takes an index, a character array, an offset, and the length of characters, and inserts, starting at that position, the index position, that subarray into the current string builder. Also, it can take an offset and the character array and inserts the character, the data array, into this builder at the position offset. So again, at that position, inserts the entire character array. Also, you can insert the primitive type value into the array at that offset. You can insert a different string into the current string builder at an offset. You can replace starting from a start index up to an end index. So it's like delete all of that and replace it with the string S. Reverse basically reverses the string in place. So it basically does that algorithm that takes the last character, puts it at the beginning, swaps it with the first, takes the previous to last and swaps it with the second, and so on. Set character at takes a character in index and the character and changes the character at that index to the new character. All of these are basically modifying the current string. You can see the last one doesn't even return anything. It returns void because you are actually modifying the character in that string builder. So here I have examples. So let's assume that I have an empty string builder, and to that I append Java. Now the string builder becomes Java. Then I insert at position 2, so 0, 1, 2, HTML end. So I get JA and then HTML end va. Then I have a delete between positions 3 and 4. So between positions 3, which is M, and 4, not including 4, it deletes the M. So it deletes the T. So it deletes from position 3 to 4, which is just the T. Delete the character at index 5 is the space, so it deletes it. Reverse the string builder, it reverses the string builder. Replace from position 4 to 8, not including 8, with HTML. So it basically from position 4 to 8 replaces that string with HTML and sets a character at index 0 to W. So this A is set to the W. So all of these are modifying the current string builder. All of the other methods that were available for arrays are also available for string builders. So you can get two string as a string, you can get the character at any index, you can get the length of the string builder as a string, you can set the length to a new length, which basically deletes everything that was after that end of the length. Substring takes an index and returns the string, the substring starting from that index to the end of the string builder. Or you take two indices and returns that substring between the start index to the end index minus one. Doesn't include the character at end index. And trim to size reduces the storage used internally from string for string builder. Internally, string builder uses a linked list. And basically, that's how you can delete characters anywhere in the string builder. Trim to size basically does kind of like a smarter encoding of the linked list internally. Now, how do you actually build a class? When you implement a class, you should start from the beginning with designing correctly the class. So a class should describe a single entity. In Java, you want classes to, and any other programming languages, you want a single entity with as basically not too many responsibilities. If you have a single entity with too many responsibilities, you should break it into smaller subclasses with separate responsibilities. Classes in general are designed for reuse. So having now responsibilities separately makes it easier to take only that class and reuse it. Provide always for any class that you are constructing a no argument constructor, an override method, override the method equals, basically define your own equals that returns public boolean equals takes another object as the input. A toString method that returns a string representation of the object with no parameters. And that's basically it. Always try to implement these methods so you can basically treat every class in the same way that you would treat any other class. Any questions? I was planning to get into inheritance also, but I think we should stop here today because we actually did a lot and I want to actually do inheritance next class from scratch. So that's all for today. If you have any questions, I can respond to them. Can you override the cloning or copying like in C++? Okay, so in Java for basically having the clone method, you have to implement a special interface called clonable. The interesting thing about the clonable interface is that is what is called the marker interface. That means that you don't need to implement any method. Basically, that interface doesn't have any methods. It's just marking this class, saying that it can be cloned, meaning that you can basically use a method clone, which returns an object. And usually the way that is implemented is that you use super.clone. So super.clone actually uses the clone method in the super class. We need to return this. And also this throws an exception, clone not supported exception. So this is how you do it. This is basically how you are implementing that this class is clonable. I will discuss about this when we get to interfaces later this semester. By the way that super.clone works is that it's binary copy. So it takes the memory location and just copies the bits. So for instance, if you have references like data fields that are references to other objects, you get a shallow clone, you get a shallow copy that basically you get a new object, but the references are same to the same objects as before. So remember that we were discussing last class about that date. So let's say that you have java.util.date, some date data field, okay? Maybe it's set to the current day. And the clone method basically just copies now the reference into a new object. They are both pointing to the same date. So it's not a deep clone, it's not a deep copy, it's a shallow copy, but that's the way it's done in Java. Okay, that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll continue with interfaces next, inheritance next class. Thank you.